AI has a problem, and it is a doozy. The solution, if there even is one, could be decades away. And in the meantime, the only way for us to mitigate the damage is for humans to be better. And here's the problem. AI is too confident. And this is a huge deal because humans are terrible at spotting false confidence. 43% of people who use AI trust what it says, but they shouldn't. Right now, there are no AIs that can fact-check themselves, no AIs that know if what they're saying is true, and there is no real plan to make one that does that anytime soon. We got a lot to cover, so let's kick into it. This problem looks a lot like the human cognitive bias of the Dunning-Kruger effect. The idea that we learn a little bit about something and then we get a ton of unearned confidence on that topic. A lawyer asked ChatGPT to help him write a brief for a case. It's an AI, it knows things, right? The AI confidently wrote a brief that cited legal precedent and it created arguments based on case law and it included links and everything. Incredible. The lawyer took it to court only to find out the AI had made it all up. The AI was confidently incompetent, and thus, so was he. If he'd known more about how that system worked, then he wouldn't have fallen prey to the Dunning-Kruger bias. But the AI presented that same bias, confidently stating completely made-up facts because it read it on the internet. By the end of this video, you'll know how that bias works, how the AI works, and why it's not to be trusted, which would help you sidestep, I think, the worst problem we're gonna face in the next decade, confident incompetence. But don't take my word for it.
It's not formulating thoughts and reasonings. It's not adding original ideas. It has no idea what it's saying.
In 1995, MacArthur Wheeler walked into two banks in Pittsburgh and he robbed them. He didn't wear a disguise, he didn't have a mask, he smiled at the security cameras. And then when police used the footage to arrest him, he was shocked. He thought lemon juice had made him invisible to video cameras. And if this story was told in 2023, I'd guess that an AI told him that. This robbery inspired two psychologists, David Dunning and Justin Kruger, to spin up a whole area of research about cognitive biases. Their 1999 paper formed the idea of the Dunning-Kruger effect. The Dunning-Kruger effect is now this tool that we use to understand people. Like, for example, your aunt who read that one Facebook post and now thinks she's a constitutional scholar. And now we know how to treat that problem. They have to go learn more stuff. The DK effect says that that learning causes the confidence to wane. Topics go from simple things to complicated and more real. And eventually we realize that we do know something, but there is a ton we don't know. And from there, our confidence normalizes. And this happens all the time for humans, thinking about what you know and you don't know. But for AI, AI has no mechanism to learn what it doesn't know. In college, I spent hours on AOL Instant Messenger. I would chat with my friends and I would have really good away messages, if I do say so myself. And there was this chatbot on AIM named Smarter Child. And you could ask it all sorts of questions, like about the weather or movie times. You could get jokes or advice about your crushes, which I did a lot. And then a little bit later, after I graduated, Siri was launched. And you could do the same thing with Siri, except you could talk to it.
What's up, homies?
The thing about both of these technologies is at the time, they were revolutionary. But a lot of their responses weren't made by the bot. They were pre-scripted by real people. And that meant that sometimes if the bot didn't know the answer or wasn't confident in its response, the people behind it had written something that would tell you that. Like, Siri would do this.
I don't understand. My apologies.
Right, and it still does. Today's AI do not work this way. ChatGPT creates answers, even for complex and confusing concepts, from scratch. And sure, it gives you a boilerplate paragraph about being a language model, but clearly people ignore that. And AIs, they don't have reasoning. They don't create original ideas. They don't even know English. Seriously, to understand why all this is true, you need to know how they work. An AI like ChatGPT is actually known in the industry of AI and machine learning as a large language model, or LLM. They use training data to mathematically generate text. The training data is secret, but we know that it was taken from all over the internet. Reddit, fan fiction websites, Wikipedia, any site that an AI company can get their little pointers on, they're gonna take it from. The LLMs then take those billions and billions of pages and note each word, what word comes before it, what word comes after it, punctuation and commas and paragraphs and word choices. And throughout those billions of conversations, it can make mathematical patterns, inferences, that look just like real conversations when put back together, but they're not.
At the end of the day, you know, it's the same as any other machine learning system. If you ask me a question, if you want me to finish a sentence, what does human realistic text look like in this context? Sometimes it's right, and sometimes it's wrong. I could bring up a very fun and complicated like diagram of what a transformer model looks like, and then you multiply this by like 1 billion of them.
The transformer model is what makes LLMs possible. This model assembles sentences based on the statistical likelihood that those words would appear in that order. Statistically, do eighth graders use the word antithetical? No. Should it start a new paragraph here? What word would come after this word? And so on and so forth. The model has no idea what it is writing, whether what it is writing is correct, or even if it is good. It looks at all the data it has and decides what, statistically, should come next in the sentence, and then does that again and again and again and again. The AI doesn't read the thing when it's done and revise it. It just delivers text to you like a word factory.
These systems don't have inherent fact-checking mechanisms, and so you should fact check them. Like, you should do the work. If you have a data set that has only been trained on descriptions that involve the sky being purple and you ask it what color the sky is, it's going to say the sky is purple.
And this is why AIs have a Dunning-Kruger problem. It may come as a surprise that internet conversations are not always factual. So when the AIs scraped all of this data out of the net, there was no distinguishing fact or crap, and that means it's often wrong, sometimes spectacularly so. Admittedly, I did ask ChatGPT to write a video in the style of Trace Dominguez.
Oh my gosh, Primey, you gotta hear this. Welcome, seekers. Today we're exploring the world of superpowers and asking the question,
buddy,
what's
whoa.
The worst one?
Whoa, 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 buddy, hold up, hold your horses.
You mentioned the ChatGPT script. Wasn't I supposed to like burst in and be all wacky? It says so in the script.
At the end, buddy. At the end.
My bad, Primey. I'm sorry. It was supposed to be at the end, so I'll just wait out here for a while longer, and I'll see you in a second.
It's okay, pal.
Bye.
That's fine. I'll see you in a few minutes. Okay, so like I said, I asked ChatGPT to write a video in the style of, well, me. And I asked it to cite papers with links. It did cite something called AI Magazine, which doesn't exist, and a bunch of other imaginary journals, and it provided URLs that didn't go anywhere because they weren't real. And if I didn't know to check, I'd be in trouble.
I've also actually done this for thesis stuff for my PhD, where it's been like, I want you to give me summary on like this topic and provide like academic references. It'll give me PubMed links, and they're all broken, like none of them work.
AI LLMs are useful tools. People use them to get jobs, brainstorm ideas, and even, seriously, write literal congressional legislation. But people should know this one thing about chatbot AI systems. They don't actually know anything.
There was that Twitter account that was like the grandpa that was like, thought they were searching Google, but really they were tweeting. Imagine that you're asking that grandpa. Like, proceed with that level of awareness of the information that you will be getting as a result.
I like to think of AI as a toddler. If you ask a 3-year-old for a paper with citations and quotes and page numbers from To Kill a Mockingbird, that toddler is going to do their best. But if it's wrong, whose fault is it? Because you asked a toddler to do it.
And also sometimes when you ask a toddler or like a kid to like give you an answer to something, they come up with something that's like inspired and genius.
Yeah, you're just like, that was very profound, Nathan.
Yeah. When I was in, I don't know, middle school, like late elementary, early middle school, Wikipedia was the website that like, we were all like, yeah, we can get all our information from here, and so we don't have to do any like research. Then all of our teachers were like, it might be wrong. You haven't done any fact checking. You should actually look into the work itself. Language models are the modern, like early 2000s Wikipedia, where they're useful potentially to get information. They do not have inherent fact-checking systems.
AI's Dunning-Kruger problem is that it's never going to get over that competency hump. In order to be factual and truly learn, it needs to know what it doesn't know. And if you want to program it to fact-check, you might be out of luck.
I don't think that these systems are optimized to do this kind of work. And I think that they've been advertised and marketed as if they can. Finding a mathematical formula that optimizes for this output is true is almost impossible, because so much of it depends on your definitions of true and fair and things like that.
That doesn't mean we shouldn't use them and respect them. It just means that we shouldn't trust them without lots of human review.
I don't want to tell people not to use AI systems or to use language models, because I do. I use them to help me brainstorm video ideas. I use them to help me write scripts. Please don't write congressional legislation without fact-checking it first, but if you want to use it to write congressional legislation, I'm like, sure, whatever.
It has been used to write congressional legislation. Congressional staffers said that original contributions and ideas were added, which is just not how these things work. They're amazing tools, but they don't create ideas. 26% of teachers in the U.S. found that their students use ChatGPT to cheat. Not always well, but it's not like it's going to go away, so I wanted people to know how these work and how useful they can be as tools. 46% of Americans are using AI systems like LLMs at work, with more than two-thirds of those AI-augmented workers keeping this a secret. And it's the latter part that's worrying. There shouldn't be a stigma for using the tools as long as the data is secure, but the tools are really more for brainstorming. Chat tools shouldn't be used to write whole drafts and pass them off as original work. If you take away one thing in this video, it's that LLMs present their work with confidence that is totally unearned. Like your uncle who read a single Facebook post and can now solve the world's problems. But if you take away a second thing from this video, it's that LLMs are not writers. They're not creating anything. They're regurgitating writing that was already done. Also, they do it with confidence, and that confidence is the problem because it makes you think it's correct. A 2023 Pew Research study found that only 18% of Americans were more excited than concerned about the rise of AIs in everyday life, so like one in five. Meanwhile, almost half, 47%, are equally excited and concerned, meaning almost half of people are feeling conflicted. That's a good thing, I think. You know, not too skeptical, not too invested, but you know, that's my opinion. What do you think? In 1950, Alan Turing wrote a paper titled Computer Machinery and Intelligence, and in it he asked, can machines think? And he came up with the Turing test, the idea that an intelligent computer can chat with a human and the human would think they're chatting with another human. There are a lot of critiques of this, but we're there. People are passing AI-based writing off as human writing, and it's working on a worldwide scale. But there's another Turing test out there, one that looks for computers that think and act rationally. And how our AIs do things now is not even close. Today's LLMs are tools. They need the human brain and the human creative thinking to fill out the giant data sets, to make them useful, not to mention prompt them and tell them what to make. And then, of course, revise it and prompt them again. If you force them into it, an AI can pretend to look like they know what they're doing, but they have no idea. Or to paraphrase Buzz Lightyear, they're not flying. They're falling with style. In 2008, Smarter Child was bought by Microsoft and taken offline. But before it went down, you could ask Smarter Child about sleep, and it would say, I dream of a better world. Me too, buddy. Me too. Thanks to Jordan Harrod for joining me to answer my silly AI questions. Jordan and I talked for more than an hour, and so I thought it would be cool to add some of those big chunks of that conversation here at the end. I hope you find it as interesting as I did. We even talk about a comic book I really like called Paper Girls. In it, there's an AI, not even a character, just like a moment in the side plot that's like two or three pages. And it's only a very minor spoiler that they go into the future at some point, so they talk to this AI tree that's in a public library. The thing is, if we do that now, not only would it not be able to give you a factual answer, it wouldn't even be able to necessarily understand the question if you were from the wrong background based on who programmed it. To see all that, sign up for Nebula and watch this video. Well, the end of it anyway. And you'll be able to get all that conversation. And the reason I can do that is because Nebula is creator-owned. I invested into it early on and I really think it's awesome. We have our own originals. We have Nebula Plus, which is a bigger video than what exists in the wider internet. We have Nebula First, where some people release their videos a whole episode ahead of what comes out elsewhere. We even make podcasts. I have a podcast called That's Absurd, Please Elaborate. And if you didn't know that I have that, now you know. And I couldn't have done it without the help of Nebula. If you're not on Nebula, join with my code and you'll be able to see extended cuts of my videos, the other creators' videos, and the originals. Like, for example, Maggie Mae Fish's Unrated, which I watched the other day, and it's about the risque, sexy things that have existed since the beginning of the movie business and rating those movies and stuff and how that shaped the industry. Really cool stuff, only available on Nebula. So join today, support me, support the other creators on Nebula. By joining, you're gonna support me directly, so thank you for that. Creators, again, own the service, run the service, and we have more paying subscribers than Quibi ever did, so I feel good about that, and I think you should too. So thanks again for watching. I really hope that you enjoyed this video, that it was a conversation starter for you, and if it was, leave me a comment. You can send me a tweet, I guess. I don't really use that app anymore, but I'm on Blue Sky, and I do have Mastodon, and I'm on Threads, and I'm on Instagram, so you can find me. I'm Trace. Thanks again for watching. Whew! And I'll see you in the future.